Hey guys, Micah here from ebikeschool.com, and today I'm going to be showing you how to build a booster battery for an electric bike or scooter. I'm going to use this GoTrax GXL scooter here, but you can use the steps I'll show you in this video to build a booster battery for pretty much any e-bike, scooter, unicycle, skateboard, or any type of small electric vehicle. Now, the process I'm going to be using is to design a battery that is the same voltage as the battery in my vehicle, and then I'm going to put those two batteries in parallel by plugging my booster battery into the charge port on my scooter, or onto the charge port of whatever vehicle you have. Now, in this video, I'm going to take you with me while I go through all the steps to actually build this booster battery. But if this is your first time ever trying to build a lithium-ion battery, I recommend that you do a little more research first before you just jump in and start it. Building lithium-ion batteries can be dangerous if you don't know what you're doing. Now, it would take me hours to go through all of the intricate little details on safe battery building, and obviously I can't fit that into a 10-minute video. So if you want to learn more about building lithium-ion batteries, I highly recommend you check out my book, DIY Lithium Batteries: How to Build Your Own Battery Packs. It's like 17 bucks on Amazon, where people are really happy with it, and it'll probably save you money along the way while you learn all the safe procedures for working with, designing, and building your own batteries. Alright, now that I got the sales pitch out of the way, let's start building this battery. The GoTrax GXL scooter has a 36 volt battery, so to make my own 36 volt battery, I'll have to connect 10 lithium ion battery cells in series. But the LG MJ1 cells I'm using are only 3.5 amp hours each. The scooter has a 5.2 amp hour battery, and I want my battery to be a bit bigger so I can approximately double the range. So I'm going to use two cells in parallel. When you add cells in parallel, it increases capacity. When you add cells in series, it increases voltage. Before I begin, I'm just going to measure the voltage of all my cells and ensure that they're at equal voltage. You don't want to connect cells together if the voltages are very different, as there'd be a large current flow from one to the other as they try to charge the lower voltage cells. Now I can prepare to connect my cells together. I could use a spot welder, which is the professional way to make battery connections, and it's the way battery factories do it. But not everyone has a $100 or $200 spot welder. So I'm going to use my Vruzin No Spot Weld battery building kit from Vruzin.com to make the connections. The V1.5 kit will be sufficient since this is going to be a low power battery. If I was building a higher power battery for a bigger vehicle or using fewer cells in parallel, I'd probably want to use the V2 kit, which is rated for higher current per cell. Now I can just go ahead and snap together all the caps for both sides of the battery at once, since the pack is only two cells wide. If I was making larger parallel groups, I'd probably do one row at a time, so it would be easier to push the two halves together. But since this battery is so narrow, it's simpler to just do the two halves at once. Notice the positive and negative caps are alternated. That will allow me to easily make my series connections next. Be careful that you put the correct end of the cells in the correct caps. Positive is obviously red, and negative is blue. Once I've pushed the two halves of my battery together, I'll use my voltmeter to double check that I can read the voltage from every cell. If I can read the voltage, it means I'm making a good electrical contact. Now I can add my series and parallel bus bars. I'll start on the first cell, which is the negative terminal of the pack. The positive of the first cell gets connected to the negative of the second cell. Then when I flip the battery over, the positive of the second cell gets connected to the negative of the third cell. I continue this pattern until I reach the last cell group. Notice on the first and last cell groups that I use wire clamps instead of normal bus bars. That will allow me to add my charge and discharge leads later. For the BMS, I'm going to use a two-wire BMS, which is different from most BMSs because it can charge and discharge from the same connector. This is helpful because if I were to plug the battery into my scooter while it was at a lower voltage than the scooter, charge would flow backwards into the backup battery. Most three-wire BMSs can still be charged via the discharge connector, but they might not have the same protections built in. So if possible, a two-wire BMS with a common charge-discharge port is better in this case. I'll first connect the B- port to the negative terminal of the battery. Then I'll connect each balance wire, starting with the -1 balance wire, then +1, then +2, then +3, all the way up to +10. Follow the instructions that come with your BMS, since each BMS can have slightly different connections. Not all have a -1 balance wire, and some start with +1 instead of -1. The P- wire from the BMS is my negative charge and discharge terminal, while the positive charge and discharge terminal is just the positive terminal of the battery itself. Even though I could use the same connector for both charge and discharge because of the two-wire BMS, I'm actually going to add separate connectors from these two same locations. That way I can leave the battery plugged into the scooter and still have a second connector to charge it. I'm also going to add the zip ties that come in the kit to help hold the two sides of the pack together under vibration. If you're building a stationary battery, this is overkill. But if you're building a battery that's going to be moving around a lot, it can be helpful to hold the two halves of the battery caps together. If it's a wide battery, you'll probably want to use some type of sandwich plate or some rigid plate, but for narrow batteries like this, zip ties are fine. Lastly, I'm going to add a bit of foam around the pack just to protect it and then slide the heat shrink around it and seal it off. You can use a heat gun for this, or you can just steal your wife's hairdryer like I did here. To hang the battery on the scooter, I'm going to try and make a simple bag for it. Now my sewing skills are not amazing, but basically I'm just going to make this the way I would make any box, with four pieces of material for the sides, one more for the bottom, and a flap for the top that I'll add some Velcro to. Then I'll also sew a loop on to hang on the scooter's handlebar hook, and another strap that will Velcro around the scooter's stem. And now when I put the battery in the bag and put it on the scooter, I can see that my sewing turned out decent, I guess, and I'm almost ready to plug in the battery. But before I plug the battery into the charge port on the scooter, there's something critical to know. What we're going to be doing is putting this battery in parallel with the battery in the scooter. And before we do that, it is critical that the two batteries are at the same voltage, or at almost the same voltage. And the way you determine that is making sure they're at the same charge level. So either they should both be at about 50% or 25%, or the easiest way to do it is just make sure they're both full. If they're both at 100% charge, then you know they're at the same voltage. So before I plug in this battery, I'm going to charge up the booster battery, and I'm going to charge up the scooter. And because I use the same charge port on the battery as the scooter, I can just use the same charger for both of them. And now that I've got the two at the same voltage, I can go ahead and plug them in. So now my scooter and my booster battery are connected together. In addition to the 5.2 amp hour battery I have in the scooter, I've got another 7 amp hours of battery in the booster battery. Ideally, that would give me about 1.3 times more range, but in practice, I find this will give me about twice as much range as normal because you're not going to get all the efficiency out of the battery, and it's not going to completely transfer all of its power into the scooter battery by the time the scooter battery has discharged itself. So in actuality, we're going to about double the range with this system. But that's still pretty good, considering before I was getting about 8 or 9 miles in the most aggressive driving mode on the scooter, so now I'm getting about 16 to 18 miles or so. Pretty decent for a homemade battery. Alright, thanks for watching, guys. Last but not least, time to announce the winner of the book giveaway for my last video, and the randomly selected commenter is... Holland Grass. So congratulations, Holland Grass. Shoot me a message, let me know which one of my books you'd like. Either the Ultimate Do-It-Yourself E-Bike Guide, DIY Lithium Batteries, or DIY Solar Power. Let me know where to send it. And anybody else who wants a chance to win one of my books for free, all you have to do is put a comment below this video. You can say anything you want, and hopefully you'll be the randomly selected commenter at the end of my next video. And if you don't want to wait until then to get a book, you can always find my books on Amazon. Thanks for watching, guys. See you next time.